On the Pleasures of No Longer Being Very Young, written by G.K. Chesterton. Presented to you by Dr. Vinamrata. Hello dear students. Today we are going to critically analyze this piece of essay which talks about the pleasures of becoming old. Generally, people think vice versa. They feel that as you grow old, you become disillusioned with life, you lose the vigor for life. But it is not so. There are certain perks associated with getting old. First of all, you get to know the world in a more better way because you have seen a lifespan, and after assessing that lifespan, you come to understand that old age is something which makes you wise. Wisdom is associated with old age. And Chesterton also says that not only wisdom, there are certain childish traits that also some old people develop. So it's not just that as soon as you become old, you become wise. Many people may not. But there are certain other perks associated with becoming old. So let's analyze what are those perks. So first, about Chesterton. Gilbert Keith Chesterton, 29th of May 1874 to 14th of June 1936. He was a writer, philosopher, critic. He has been referred to as the Prince of Paradox. And this certain essay also, you will see his essay full of proverbs, full of paradoxes. And those proverbs and paradoxes are generally his writing skills. So he generally wrote proverbial sentences. Time magazine says, whenever possible, Chesterton made his points with popular sayings, proverbs, allegories, first carefully turning them inside out. So that was the magic of Chesterton. And you can very well see that magic coming to life in this essay. Now, moving on to the essay. We are talking about old age versus young age. This essay explores the theme of youth, maturity, innocence, conflict, and happiness, exploring the differences between youth and maturity. A person may not necessarily have the same beliefs as an old person due to the fact that they have lived their lives in different time frames. Chesterton argues that an older person is happier because they are more equipped for life. Should they get stuck in life, they have the advantage of taking a proverb and understanding their position. The same is not true for a younger person, because the younger person has not lived those times, so he is not able to understand the meaning of the proverbs deeply. So there are n number of proverbs which are used throughout the essays to prove the points. Old people have seen the world change, and hence they know the worth of ancient and tradition. Once you reach the position of the old, then only you realize the truth. Because in young age, you are so much full of vigor, excitement, and you are in a different time frame. You don't tend to understand what are the real meaning of the proverbs. Only when you gain experience, only when you live those things time to time, time by time, till the time you get old, you come to understand the meaning of those proverbs. So, moving on to the essay. There are advantages in the advance through middle age into later life, which are very seldom stated in a sensible way. Generally, they are stated in a sentimental way. In a general suggestion that an old man are equipped with beautiful snowy beards like Father Christmas and rejoice in unfathomable wisdom like Nestor. All this has caused the young people to be skeptical about the real advantages of the old people. And the true statement of those advantages sounds like a paradox. I would not say that old men grow wise, for men never grow wise, and many old men retain a very attractive childishness and cheerful innocence. Unquote. So you see, this is the first para written by Chesterton in the essay. And here only he has explained everything, because he has told that as one becomes old, it is generally thought that people become very beardy, they have snowy beards, the hair become white. So the hair is associated with snowy beards. It is a metaphor used here. And they look like Father Christmas. They start looking like Santa Claus. Or they gain too much wisdom, unfathomable wisdom, like Nestor, who was a jester. But no, it's not that. Many of the old people have their childishness. But what happens that because they are portrayed in such a way, young people tend to feel that or become skeptical about the real advantages of growing old. And the real advantages of growing old is that it's not that old men become wise all of a sudden, no. But yes, they gain experience while getting old. That should be sought in a more sensible way, Chesterton says. And Chesterton starts with these lines trying to prove that it's not just age which determines your thinking process or your maturity. Age is just a number. And he quotes this proverb, "There is no fool like an old fool." Because this proverb is also very famous, and you might have seen when people become old, there are generally many people who become forgetful, who lose their senses as they approach their old age. So generally this proverb is also associated with old people. It's not that all old people become wise. They even get to become more childish at old ages. And then he says that for old people, everything around is fresh and new. For why everything around them is fresh and new? Because they have lived their life as a youth. At that time, when they looked around, they saw people giving them lectures on doing this, not doing that, and all those things. But when they grow old, what they see around them young people. So when they see around them new things coming up, new technologies coming up, new advancement in the world, then they feel everything is fresh and young around them, and they are the one who are old. So for old people, everything is fresh and new. Chesterton further moves to explain the significance of old age and how old proverbs and maxims now start making sense to him. As for young people, it is very difficult to comprehend the proverbs as they are all together on a different plane and see the old world around them like a place full of tombs. They feel it to be antiques. They feel it to be out of relevance. They feel it that they it is being forced upon them. So Chesterton asserts this fact that it is a mistake made by young generation. As they grow old, they realize the truth. But till then, the time is gone. Every proverb has a significance. He gives examples like, "It's an ill wind that blows nobody good." So it is a proverb which is generally quoted. And once you understand this proverb, once you see how the wind affects the climate, and if the ill wind is blowing, it is not good for anyone. It may cause diseases. Then only you will understand the real meaning of the proverb. And it is youth in revolt, even in righteous revolt, which sees its surrounding as dead and unmeaning. Because youth are always in a kind of vigor. They feel that they have to revolt, they have to bring revolution, they have to do something new. And in doing that, in that process, they feel that everything old, every old proverbs are coming like a kind of hindrance in their life. And they seem it to be dead and it to be unmeaningful. So it is old age, and even second childhood, he calls old age as second childhood, that he comes to see that everything means something and life itself has never died. So he talks about the wheel of fortune and gives one proverb there also. And he says that the wheel of fortune turns all around. Anything which rises will fall down. As we have heard from our childhood, from very childhood we have heard this proverb that there is a wheel of fortune, and once you gain something, the wheel of fortune will turn around, a time will come you will lose it. And if you are a loser now, if you are a failure now, maybe a time will come when you will succeed. But we never pay attention to it. We never pay attention to the wheel of fortune and the reality associated with it. But he gives example. He gives lots of examples trying to prove this point of wheel of fortune and trying to prove this proverb. And he says, like giving the example of all the superpowers and industrial countries like Britain, Germany, Ireland. He says they all had their fall. There was a time when the sun never set for the British Empire. But did it stay forever? No, it had a fall. Their riches were gone, their fortunes turned upside down. He proves it with many a proverbs. Like, there are so many proverbs which we have learned from our childhood. Fortune is fickle, riches take to themselves wings and fly, park and depart suddenly from the powerful, pride goes before a fall, insolence attracts the thunderbolt of gods. So time to time, proverb by proverb, we have been told this point that, okay, one must not be basking in power and glory if one gets it, because one must always be aware of the wheel of fortune. There may be a time when the fortune may be gone, but we don't tend to believe it. We tend to be basking in our power when we get it. So, but it was all unmeaningful to us, and all the proverbs seem stiff and stale like dusty labels on neglected antiquities. So we never cared for it, for these proverbs. We thought that they are just like dusty labels on old monuments and antiques on display. Nobody is caring about them. But no, that's not true. Truth is that they all prove themselves. We tend to neglect the point. And then again he gives the example of so many kings like Charles V, who had to resign his throne. Charles I, who was beheaded. Just it and proves that all empire, be it Britain or Germany, has to or had to fade away. And one day, everything will go down. But people don't believe the proverbs till they face the situation. Then he quotes one Latin proverb which says, "Sic transit gloria mundi," which means, "Thus passes worldly pleasure." Worldly pleasure is very fickle. Worldly pleasure is not permanent. Worldly pleasure is temporary. It is today, it may not be today. So one gets to know about this from the n number of proverbs we have been listening from our childhood. The only folly we commit is that we don't tend to believe those proverbs. Now Chesterton gives certain examples of how proverbs seem to old people. He gives us a diagram which suddenly becomes solid. When you start realizing the proverb, you come to see that the just like any diagram which is on the copy, and you feel that, okay, it has suddenly become solid, or it's like something inorganic which has become organic, means something which has come to life, something which was dead before has come to life now. He gives an example of like snakes and birds from some ancient Egyptian inscription. Some inscription which is carved on the walls of Egypt are coming up to life. So the thing was dead maxim when we were alive with youth, and it becomes a living maxim when we are nearer to death. Even as we are dying, the whole world is coming to life. Only when we get old, only when we get towards the verge of death, then we understand the reality of these things. In youth, we thought them to be dead. And in old age, we now realize that no, they were not dead, they were so much real. So, again quoting Chesterton, he says, another paradox is this, that it is not the young people who realize the new world. The moderns do not realize modernity. They have never known anything else. So, they don't know that this is the modern world. They have stepped onto a moving platform which they hardly knew to be moving. As a man cannot feel the daily movement of the earth, but he would feel it sharp enough if the earth suddenly moved the other way. So he says that for the old people, they have seen the transition. They have seen that there was once tradition and now modernity is coming. So they feel that, okay, there is a sharp change from tradition to modernity. But for young people, they have not seen it. They have seen just modernity. they have seen just from the very beginning that, okay, this is the world in which we are born and it is a modern world, it is full of modernity. So they don't realize the truth of the situation. At last, Chesterton says that in earlier days, people were more unorthodox than now. And no one would believe in the story of a country ghost and would never make it a daily ritual to visit church. So it is better proven in what direction we are moving. Quoting him, "Amused to hear a young man say the world is moving away from supernatural. They know in which direction it has really moved." Unquote. So he says that in earlier days, people were less superstitious than now. And although people are claiming themselves to be modern, but it is not so. So that was all about the essay. At last, I would like to end it with Old is Gold. Thank you.